Welcome to a new edition of the Neon Jazz Interview Series with Canadian jazz saxophonist Keith O'Rourke. He talked about the new 2023 project called Imperfect Perfectionists. As with many artists, the pandemic shutdowns of 2020 became a time of soul searching for Keith. His sophomore album is a direct result of this unexpected and prolonged period of self-reflection, practice, and composition. He was born and raised Albertan, and after traveling the world and seven seas honing his craft, he returned to Calgary in 2008. He's got a great story. Enjoy the interview.
Good. Hey, thanks for taking a minute out for the show. I appreciate it.
Thanks for reaching out. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, you bet. So before we get into Imperfect Perfectionist, I want to know how, as a recording artist, you survived COVID and how, you know, now that we're kind of coming out of it, you have a new album, how you're approaching things a little differently.
With COVID, I basically hunkered down and practiced and with a little help from the government with some of their plans and the savings. I thankfully had been saving up to build a soundproof room in my place, and so I had a little bit of a budget to work with. I literally just, after grieving a little bit of the loss of my gigs for the first month or so, I just hunkered down and got a lot of practice in and worked towards writing. Now that things are opening up a bit more, it's like I'm just trying to, you know, reach out and get back out there and launch things and see if I can, you know, make things happen again, because before the pandemic, things were kind of looking great.
Well, and I guess that's what I was going to get to with a new album, the beginning of a new year. It has to feel pretty good to, you do have this album. There, you know, hopefully things are in a much better place. So talk to me a little bit about how this album feels and kind of how you constructed this one.
Yeah, I kind of just, as the lockout, you know, happened, like the lockdown, I just kind of, as I was working on things, part of my daily practice is to do a bit of writing. So I just kind of wrote towards things and, you know, thought about things, thought about myself, worked on some projects. So, so there's Baker's Stripes. I started during the pandemic baking a lot of bread and actually fundraising for this album by doing that. I ended up baking early in the morning, and I'm not a morning person at all. And ended up burning my arm a few times on the top of my oven. And literally, that song is all like all the little shots and hits are me basically, yeah, maybe a little cursing. Like the owl was like, that's kind of where that one was. And I was just kind of thinking about things personally, like the tortoise and the hare, like. I kind of, you know, think about, like, you know, my development. It's like, I was not a young phenom right out of university that sounded amazing. I had to work hard at it for a lot of years to get to where I'm at now. So the tortoise is kind of me, and then catching up to the hare, of like some of my friends that were the phenoms that, maybe haven't done as much.
So talk to me a little bit about how this music journey began for you.
Honestly, started with a great high school band teacher. They got me really interested in music. And then as I got into university, all of a sudden people were introducing me to jazz and more styles. And it just kind of, that love and passion kind of took off with things. And yeah, it's like, it's tricky living, but I really love doing it because the fact that you can be creative every day and approach things and learn every day and constantly strive to be better. That's a big thing for how I'm built. So music seems like a great calling for me.
So what was the very first live jazz show or show you saw that really made you think you wanted to do that someday?
The one that really struck me was, I don't know if it's the first one, but it's the first one that just like left me like just jaw dropped, was Joe Lovano when he was touring his quartets album. Anthony Cox on bass. It was just an insane group. And I just remember hearing that and the freedom in Joe's playing. And yeah, it just, and the sound, like Joe's sound is like beautiful and pure and huge. It felt like he could fill the hall without a single microphone or amp. And that one was a big one for me. It left me kind of you know, stunned and in awe and inspired.
So, you know, the baritone is one of those instruments, obviously, which is a big, big sound. I'm curious, why did you pick that instrument?
It's just fun. Like, I don't know, the low notes. So one of the first opportunities I got to do a lot of playing with higher level players was on the baritone sax, because everybody has a tenor or an alto, and there weren't that many people playing bari at the time. And the fact that I had been playing one in university and was comfortable on it led to the first few opportunities. And it just kind of, like, I don't know, sometimes things call you as opposed to you choosing them. Like, so it feels wrong to me not to play a little bit of bari here and there. But I do kind of spend my time on bari, tenor, and alto these days mostly. Yeah, a little bit of each. But yeah, it's literally just happenstance. Like, there's so many great tenor players and alto players, and they needed a bari player for a big band, and I had one from the university, and it allowed me to, you know, kind of step up and get my feet wet and take some chances.
So, you know, the one thing about your itinerary and playing over the years, that you've been around a lot of, you know, veterans and people that have been in the game longer than you. What have you learned from them that you in turn teach younger players you get around?
Oh, that's a great question. The passion for music, like just finding the joy in it. Sometimes, like, the biggest thing is can be listening. So often we're focused on what we're playing that we're not really listening to, or especially students when they're learning, they're so worried about playing, like, what do I play over a C7 or an F7 or, you know, an altered chord. It's like, and, you know, so they get so wrapped up in the nitty gritty, the fine details that they stop listening for the conversation that's happening in music between, you know, saxophone, bass, drums, piano, if you have it. Yeah, that's one of the things I like to remind students of. And then, yeah, and just enjoy it. Like, the thing about music, nobody's going to die if there's a wrong note. It's not like we're surgeons or something.
Of all the things that go into being a professional musician, what do you like the best about it?
Freedom, the chance to see the world. I've had a chance to play all over, and then often when playing in festivals and somewhere we haven't been, you get people walk or introducing you, showing things around, or at least giving you a few recommendations, so you can kind of get to see a fair bit of a place, even though you're only there for a day or two. But yeah, the travel has been great.
If you could get into a time machine and go back in time and see anybody, who would you go see? Who have you not seen that you would have loved to have seen live?
Oh, well, Coltrane live would be amazing. Stan Getz live, but I would love to see him. I've seen Sonny Rollins play live, but I would love to have seen Sonny Rollins in the 50s and back in that day when, you know, around the time of that Saxophone Colossus album or the Clifford Brown stuff he worked with. That would be amazing to see. I'd probably see Sonny, even though I've heard him play live now.
Yeah, that would be amazing. You know, everyone out there has a perception of you, your family, your friends, your fans, but ultimately you're the one that's in control of your life. You're the one that lives it. What's your perception of you? Who do you think you are?
I think I'm just the humble guy that plays the saxophone. Guy trying to be better and you know, share my love for it. I'm pretty, pretty humble about things. Like, I hope that's what people see.
So, Imperfect Perfectionist, if anyone out there wants to get a copy, stream it, anything related to this album, or any live shows with you, where's the best place for them to go?
ChronographRecords.com is the best place to purchase it, or Bandcamp. And for streaming, it's on all the streaming services. And then live performances, I'm a little bit behind on my website, but yeah, my website should be current in the next couple of days or so. KeithO'Rourke.ca. is where you can track down my calendar.
Cool. Hey, Keith, thank you for taking some time out to talk about the album, your life, and music. I look forward to spending it on the show. Thanks again.
Thanks, Joe.
Thanks for listening and tuning in to another Neon Jazz interview, where we give you a bit of insight into the finest players in Alberta, Kansas City, and spots all over the world, giving fans all that jazz. And thanks to Keith for his time, energy, and stories. If you want to hear more interviews, go to Famous Interviews with Joe Domino on the iTunes Store. Visit neonjazz.youtube.com. And for everything Neon Jazz, go to theneonjazz.blogspot.com. Until next time, enjoy the jazz, my friends.
Neon Jazz.